Geçen hafta process synchronization konuşmuştuk. Okay, so today we are going to talk about deadlocks and deadlock avoidance, deadlock prevention, the principle of deadlocks and the conditions for the deadlocks to occur and so on. So we will talk about deadlock characterization, methods for dealing with the deadlocks, prevention of deadlocks, avoidance, detection, and if we can't do anything and deadlock happened, we will discuss how to recover from deadlock, recovery from deadlock is interesting. The concept of deadlock is interesting concept. As we discussed last time, synchronization is not only an operating systems problem, but also a generalized problem in mechanical engineering, economy, company management, so traffic management. And deadlock is also famous in very different areas. So the solutions we talk in here also apply for the other domains. So it's a generalized problem. We will discuss different methods and different ways of dealing with the deadlock problem. Sometimes the dealing is just ignoring it. Sometimes you pretend that deadlocks may not happen, and if it happens, it happens. So don't worry about it. I will reboot the machine. So that could be another solution. So in order for a deadlock to occur, there must be multiple resources and multiple processes. These processes should use multiple resources in order to finish their task. If each process uses only one resource to finish their task, then there won't be any deadlock. Because if you hold something, you finish your task. And if you are waiting for something, you will wait until another person finishes. The problem comes when two or more process start waiting for each other for a certain resource. And it happens because they are holding one resource and requesting another one. For example, a resource is here. It is used by P1. Another resource is here. It is used by P2. So R2 is used by P2. R1 is used by P1. P1 asks for R2. And P2 needs R1. But they are in use. Therefore, we have a deadlock. To make it more understandable, we should indicate resources of the same type as R and processes with P. PI, PJ, PK, etc. So each resource sometimes may have more than one instances. So resources are generally indicated with rectangles or squares. Processes are multiple instances may exist. So one resource may have three instances, for example. That means up to three processes can use it simultaneously, but the fourth one cannot be used. So if there is a request for the fourth one, the fourth guy will wait. Each process uses a resource as follows. Using request, use, and release edges. Request, use, release. So the notation will be, you request you use, and you release. Request, use, release. And there is also another one, dotted. We will discuss it later, but let me put it there. It means it may request. This is request. This is use, and that's release. Release have no connection. Screen hasn't come yet. Wait a minute. So reconnecting. Sesim geliyor değil mi şu an?
Evet.
Geliyor hocam.
Geliyor hocam.
Laptop düştü. Anlattığımı göremiyorum. Siz de göremiyor zannettim. Okay, so let me continue. In order to have a deadlock, we need to have four conditions to be satisfied. It's not a good thing, but if one of these conditions are not satisfied, that means we cannot have a deadlock. Therefore, in order to prevent or eliminate the possibility of deadlock, we will make sure that one of the conditions cannot happen. So that is one of the solutions with dealing with deadlocks. However, it's not also easy.
Hocam şu anda sunum ekranı görmüyoruz ama haberiniz olsun.
Evet hocam, sunum gözükmüyor. Sadece sesiniz geliyor.
Onu söylemeniz lazımdı.
Acaba sadece bendeki internetten düşündüm de başka arkadaş da olunca da dile geçirmiyorum.
Yok, tamam. Öyle bir şey olursa söyleyin. Çünkü kendi kendine vazgeçiyor bu şey. Ben de sunuyor, görünüyor. Bir daha sunuyorum. Başlat. Laptopum disconnect olduğu için kendi kendimi görüyorum normalde, sizin gördüğünüzü. O gitti zaten. So we need to have mobile'dan bağlandım. So we need to have four conditions to hold in order to have a deadlock. If one of them is not present, we will not have a deadlock. That is mutual exclusion among resources. Holding and waiting for another resource, holding at least one resource and waiting for another resource. Inability to preempt processes that are in deadlock. And waiting for other processes in a circular way so that it will look like you will be waiting yourself. So circular wait is actually waiting yourself through relations between resources and processes. Deadlocks can occur through system calls, locking mechanisms, process synchronization. So if you have mechanisms for process synchronization, they may cause deadlock. It's a good thing for preventing errors in shared variables, but once you have mutexes, semaphores for the shared variables, that means you cannot access them together, and then it may cause deadlocks if you use it, if you use them improperly or as a result of certain conditions. Generally, we will analyze deadlocks with the resource allocation graph. I'm not going to go one by one because it's kind of obvious at this point. You have processes from 1 to n. You have resources from 1 to m. So this is n processes and m resources with one instances. So now I am not talking about instances at this point. There is a request edge and assignment edges defined. So if this is called as request edge, this is called as assignment edge. So if the resource is now being used by the process, the arrow points the process. If you have multiple instances, for example, utilization using assignment edge works in this way, but the request will be to the box. So this will be the request, and but the assignment will indicate which one you are using. So it's more precise drawing. We will have the figure now. So processes are indicated with circles, rectangles or squares for the resources. This is for requesting, and this is for the assignment. If you have any questions, let me know. So we will use these notation to analyze whether there is a deadlock or whether there is a waiting for each other issue or not in a general synchronization problem. Typical type is a resource allocation graph like this, and you have three processes and four resources with multiple instances. Here you don't have any circles. So there is some kind of waiting, but that waiting will be finished as soon as this P3, everybody is now waiting for P3. When P3 finishes, this becomes connected and it will be finished using these two. When it is finished, also this is finished. When this finishes, P1 will be free and can use R1. And then after that, it will finish at the end. So P3 will finish first, P2 will finish second, and P1 will finish as a last process in this case. So there is no waiting for each other. There is no circular waiting condition is not satisfied, so no deadlock. If there is a deadlock, there should be a circle. So here we have two circles. One circle is this one. Another circle is this one. So you have two circles. Sometimes you may have a circle, but it may not be related to a deadlock because there will be more than one instances. So circle doesn't mean that you will have a deadlock, but it means you may have a deadlock. So if you don't have circle cycle, if you don't have a cycle waiting for each other, sorting circular waiting, that means you don't have a deadlock. But if you have a cycle, then that means you may have a deadlock and you need to analyze it with the number of resources. If only one instance per resource is available, and if you have a circle, you have a deadlock. But usually the problems are coming with multiple resources. So when you have multiple resources, you need to examine whether the cycle, circular weighting, causes deadlock or not by counting how many resources are available. Is there any free one? And so on. And who is blocking? Here you have a cycle, circular weighting, but circular weighting will be eliminated once P2 is finishes. Once P2 is finishes, this will be free. The R1 instance will be free. Then P1 can go on. If P1 can go on and continue, then P1 will finish. Therefore, everybody else can finish. Also, same thing can happen. If P4 finishes first and releases this, P3 can use this immediately. Therefore, now we are waiting for P2 and P4, P1 and P3, P3 are waiting for P2 or P4. That's what we have. Basically, if the graph contains no cycles, there is no deadlock. If the graph contains a cycle, there is a deadlock. If there is one instance per resource type and there is a cycle, then there is a deadlock. If several instances are available, you need to examine. So there is a possibility of deadlock. Methods for handling deadlocks are interesting. Sometimes you prevent deadlock. Sometimes you avoid deadlock. Sometimes you allow deadlocks and recover from deadlocks. So second big approach is allow the system to enter deadlock and then recover, because prevention is costly. Some other systems just ignores the deadlock problem, and it's not going to occur much frequently. So most operating systems, including Unix, does not care about deadlocks. So prevention requires four conditions to be eliminated. One of them will be eliminated. So either mutual exclusion or hold on weight or preemption or circular weight will be eliminated for prevention. If the mutual exclusion requirement can be eliminated, such as the files are read-only, so read-only file access doesn't hurt anybody, so simultaneous access can happen, then there will be no deadlock among reading processes. Second, holding and waiting. Whenever a process requests a resource, we can introduce a rule. We can introduce a rule saying that if you ask for something, you should not hold anything. If we have such an instruction, such a method, then we can eliminate deadlocks. But some processes require multiple resources to operate due to their nature, so that won't be available. That kind of work not be available. So efficiency will go down, programming complexity is not good enough, and resource utilization goes down, and starvation may become possible because you are asking for some resource, and as soon as you release the others in order to get it, you lose the other resources that you need. So then you should switch in between using temporary local data. That will make life much more complicated. So holding elimination of holding and wait is not that easy. Preemption is a solution. So if process is holding some resources, and if another process is requesting it, and if there is a deadlock, or if there is a possibility of deadlock, preemption of a process from that resource, meaning that eliminating the use cycle. So if it is being used, preemption means breaking this line by the operating system before process finishes. So if preemption is available, then there is no deadlock. Process in the preemption mechanism, process will be restarted only when it can gain its old resources as well as the new ones that it is requesting. So if everything is available, then process will be restarted. Otherwise, it will wait in the waiting queue. Last one is the circular wait. You can make sure that requesting a resource will be an ordered process. So each process will request resources in an increasing order of enumeration, so that there will be an order. If you are going to hold some resource, and if you are going to request some other resources, you should wait for your turn. Since you are waiting for your turn, okay, others will finish. You are not trying to grab something before your turn comes. So turn-taking strategies also can eliminate or prevent deadlocks. One typical example is with the mutual exclusion. You first lock the first semaphore and lock the second semaphore, do some work. You unlock the first semaphore, unlock the second semaphore. Another thread, another process or thread works in the same way, but in a different code. It's going to lock second one and first one. This one locks first and second. This will lock second and first. In order to unlock first, someone else should do this. So in this case, this is waiting for here, and that to happen, and this is waiting for this to happen. Yes, that's correct. So either one cannot move. because they are waiting for work one and work two waits for each other. While you are writing the code, you may not recognize it very easily. Therefore, having a deadlock is generally a programming error. So programmers' planning error. If you plan correctly, considering everything, then probably deadlock will not happen. Another example with the lock, two locks, mutex one, lock one, lock two. In the lock one, you get lock. From a process, lock two, get lock, another two process, get lock one, get lock two, withdraw money, deposit money, release lock two, release lock one. So if two transactions execute concurrently, transaction one transfers $25 from account A to account B, transaction two transfers $50 from account B to account A. There will be a deadlock now if they execute at the same time, because this release will require lock one to be acquired. Lock one cannot be acquired because it is waiting for this to execute. So this cannot be executed because your program, one of the program is waiting here, another program is waiting here. So process two is waiting here, process one is waiting here. They cannot move forward. Do you understand? Anladık mı arkadaşlar? İki tane proses var. P1, P2. İkisi de bu kodu execute ediyorlar. Ama birisi şurada takılıyor, birisi burada takılıyor. Niye? Çünkü arkasındakinin execute edilmesini bekliyor. O olmayınca şuradan aşağıya, buradan aşağıya gidemiyor. Acquire lock one'dan aşağıya yürüyemiyor. Yürümediği için de release olmuyor. Release olmayınca öbürü de release edemiyor. So avoidance is one strategy, but avoidance requires some extra information in advance to be shared with the operating system. So everybody should declare maximum number of resources of each type that it may need. Avoidance algorithm dynamically examines the resource allocation state to ensure that there can never be a circular wait condition. So avoidance algorithm checks periodically whenever a resource is going to be given to a process. It checks and thinks that if I give this resource, is there a possibility next time to go into a deadlock? If there is a possibility, that resource will not be given. Therefore, we need to concentrate on number of available resources, number of allocated resources, and maximum demands of the processes. They must be checked regularly. When the process requests an available resource to finish its working, system must decide if immediate allocation leaves the system in a safe state. Safe state means everything will finish without a deadlock. So all the P's in the circle, in the waiting queue for the resources, can exit without waiting for themselves. If PI, that means PI resource needs are not immediately available, then PI can wait until all PJs have finished. So if you cannot get what you want, that means you should wait. Circular wait condition is violated, then you can avoid deadlock. Second, PJ, when PJ is finished, PI can obtain needed resources, execute return allocated resource, and terminate. So finish your stuff. All others are finished, you can do it. But it is your turn. So others cannot get the resources immediately because it is your turn. So there is a turn taking for providing safe state. And if PI terminates, PI plus one, so turn taking, that is the turn taking, PI plus one can obtain its needed resources and so on. Turn taking. If safe state is not coming, then you should wait. So the general idea is if the system is in safe state, there will be no deadlocks. If the system is in unsafe state, there is a possibility of deadlock, but we cannot tell whether there is a deadlock or not. Furthermore, if we are in a deadlock, going back from deadlock is a difficult task. So it's an avoidance. So avoidance means ensure that the system will never be in unsafe state. If there is a possibility of deadlock, avoid that region so that deadlocks are eliminated. It's avoidance. Therefore, this is very important. Deadlocks are part of the unsafe state. A lot of unsafe operations may not result in a deadlock, but they are unsafe. Just like you are passing a car on the two-way road, sometimes nothing happens. Most of the times nothing happens, but it is unsafe. So you need to obey traffic rules. Most of the times you don't die, but sometimes you die. So in order to prevent you from dying, you obey the rules. So you avoid breaking the rules when you are passing another car. So it is like that. There is a lot of unsafe operations, but not causing deadlocks. That will also bring some inefficiency to the operation. So avoidance algorithms are famous. If there is one instance of each resource, then resource allocation graph is sufficient. If multiple, and it is easy, relatively easy. If multiple instances of the same type is required, then you need to count how many instances are used. So for example, you may have four instances. So you need to count these instances individually, and if there is no more instance to give, then you will consider going into unsafe state. For this fact, there is an algorithm called as Banker's algorithm. Banker's algorithm means declare what you will draw. So each customer declares how much money it can draw. That is your account. Second, there is a rule indicating that if you have money in the bank and if you want to draw, the rule says you may wait. You may wait because we may not have that kind of money all the time. we will give your money after some waiting, but you may wait your turn. And also declaration. So with the one instance version, resource allocation graph says there is a PI, RJ, and PK. So this one requests resources, and this one uses the resource. We modify this by PI is waiting for PK. So PI waits for PK. We will define a wait for graph. We will define a wait for graph rather than resource utilization graph. It makes life simpler. So we will eliminate the box in between. Normally, the rest I have explained. Resources must be claimed at the beginning in the system, in the resource allocation graph mechanism. So everybody should declare what he wants. Then if there is a cycle, it is an unsafe state. So this is resource allocation sample resource allocation graph. This sample resource allocation graph has no cycle. P1 will finish when P1 finishes, then P2 finishes later. The order of execution will be P1 and P2. There is a cycle, unsafe state. P1 may request R2, which is used by P2. P2 requests R1, and R1 is used by P1. Do we have cycle now? The answer is no. Cycle future, maybe. Maybe, because P1 may release R1 or may not. So because we don't know when this is necessary, but we know that it may be necessary. Since it may be necessary, this is called as unsafe state. It may be necessary in future. So therefore it is dotted request. Let me know if you have any questions. So in the resource allocation graph algorithm, assume that we have process PI requests resource RJ. The request can be granted only if converting the request edge to assignment edge does not result in the formation of cycle in the resource allocation graph. So when you convert that to assignment edge, if it does not result in a cycle, then we can give it. But if the coming state is unsafe state, then it will not be granted. In the banker's algorithm, when you have multiple instances, you need to count, and you need to count as a table. It is a little complicated, but the basic idea is count number of resources, and if there won't be any resource left after the new request, then don't fulfill that request. That is the main idea. Each process must declare maximum use. You may have to wait, and if you are using a resource, you should return it in a finite amount of time. You should not hold it indefinitely. So indefinite holding is something undesirable in general. So if these conditions are checked as a table, we call this algorithm as banker's algorithm. And banker's algorithm may be a question in a lot of examinations, in doctoral qualification examination, company interviews, in our class. So banker's algorithm is very famous for being asked in the examinations. For that to work, we will define several variables, one in vector form. One is the available resources, declaration matrix, which is N by M, which processes request how many from each resource, maximum request matrix. Available contains how many resources are available from each resource, how many instances are available. The allocation means who gets what. Need means after who gets what, how many more is required. So actually, there is a relation between need, max, and allocation. Maximum minus allocation is actually need. How many more is required? So as you update these matrices and checking whether you give need, it makes you an unsafe state. The idea is don't give it. The algorithm, safety control algorithm, checks those numbers, whether need is less than whether need is less than work. Work means the one you have currently. So for multiple resources, we define work and finish vectors, M resources and N processes. Usually at the beginning, work is equal to available. What was available? This. How many instances of resource types available? So make it a temporary variable. Let nobody has finished yet. So check all the eyes in the finish. Who has need less than work? So who has a need? Who has a need that can be fulfilled? So who is okay? You find an eye such that both. If no such eye exists, go to step 4. Not finished, and need is uh, need this smaller than work. Allocate. When you allocate, you say you are done. Check the other one. Check again. You may give another resource to anybody else, because it may still be in the safe state. Once you are finished with all these eyes, finish is true for all I, and you have allocated every resources possible, because you made sure that need is smaller than work. You gave the resources so that they can finish everything. For this, if this doesn't get satisfied, you don't give it. So you go to step four. In that case, since if some if some processes cannot get the resources, that means system becomes unsafe state, because not all processes can get their need safely. Therefore, if you give those resources, the system will be unsafe. Therefore, you will go back, remove that request, and run the safety algorithm again. When you run the safety algorithm again for the second time without that request, it will come out as safe. When it comes out as safe, then you will say, okay, this time I am safe and I can move on. So each case must be evaluated for every process. And if you are in a safe state, then you can move. If you are not in a safe state, go back and drop the request and run the safety algorithm again. So as you request, yeah, this is there. If the request is less than need, go to step two. That's for error checking. Second, if the request is less than available, go to step three. So I may give. Assume that you have allocated the resources, so count available minus request, allocation plus request, need, check the safety algorithm, so call safety algorithm. If all things are safe, like here, then allocate. Otherwise, don't allocate. Wait. And if something changes, run this again, or run from the beginning. Depends how you code. So this is for safety checking. This is for giving resources to processes using safety checking. So this safety checking algorithm is run before giving any kind of resource to any process. Yes, that's correct. Details and variable names are not that important. The idea is you need to check maximum boundaries of requests so that the system stays in the safe state if you give everybody what they need at the maximum capacity, even if they don't use it. So if maximum capacity will cause trouble, then you avoid giving that resource as a last step. So last step is not implemented. You wait. PI minus wait. And all resource allocation state, these all resource allocation state is restored. So there is an example. Generally, these examples are as follows. You have 5 processes from P0 to P4, 3 resource types A, B, and C. Each of them has 10, 5, and 7 instances respectively. So you have allocation matrix. So A, B, C, P0 has one of these, P1, two of these, P3, three and two of these, P3, two, one of these, and there is max. If you are going to, at time T0, if you are going to ask additional resources, you need to check max and available. Before giving, if these max conditions are below available numbers, then you give. Otherwise, you don't give it. Kapıdan kovuyoruz yani müşteriyi. Unsafe olacak diye. İçeridekiler belki parasını ister diye. For example, in that case, need 743. What is that? 753 is the max. 010 is the allocation. Need is 743. The system is in a safe state since the İnternet gitti. Şimdi geri geldi. P1. When you use P1, 1, 2, 2. If 1, 2, 2 is given, 3, 3, 2. Satisfies it. So you can start with that. Again, then P3, 011, satisfies. P4. Four, three, one. Because P1 is finished before that, so that becomes 5. Available will become 5. Then 4-3-1 will work. So in a given sequence, we will find a given sequence indicating that P0 should go first. No. P1 should go first, then P3 should go first, second, then P4, P2, P0. In that case, there won't be any conflicts regarding maximum allocation because the previous one will be finished by the time P4 is asking for new resources. So you give resources in this order so that they will finish it and release it to the others. If you give resources in the other order, for example, if you start with P0, that will not be possible because available is smaller than maximum. Since available is smaller than maximum, what happens if P0 is, for example, requests additional resources? You won't be able to give it. So since there is a possibility of being not able to give all the resources because max is high, you will wait. You don't give it to the resources that you will start with P1. You can give P1 whatever it wants because the maximum is below available. That is the main criteria. And as processes finish, available increases. As available increases, because allocation is containing some numbers, then for example, P2 is very late because it will require nine instances of A. So available must be equal or smaller than 9 in order to give resources to P3. That is Banker's algorithm. It's a conservative algorithm based on declaration. Therefore, declarations must be conservative. If you are not going to use 9 instances, it is better to not to declare it as 9 because that will make you wait. Same example, another order, P1, P3, P4, P0, P2. If by P4, 330, can we give this? The answer is no. Because need is more than available. 020 by P0. The answer is yes. when P1 requests 102, it has 302 allocation and need to, so 102. Can be given starting with P1 because it is 102 can be given. Yeah. Second method is detecting deadlocks. Allow system to enter deadlock, detect deadlock, and recover. Recovery by preemption. So preemption is one strategy after detection of a deadlock. And it is actually hard to detect a deadlock and also costly. In order to detect deadlocks, we do wait for graphs. So periodically run an algorithm that searches cycles. If there is a cycle, there is a deadlock. If you have more than one instances, so it will require more operations. But for the single instance case, if there is a cycle, that means there is a deadlock. And it is not easy because it requires n square operations. It's not an easy task, cycle detection. From resource allocation graph to wait for graph, what we do is we eliminate boxes, as I said. We will leave only who is waiting for whom. Same thing. So this is much easier for cycle detection. There's a cycle, etc. And there's another cycle. With this, again, for detection, there is available allocation and request with the several instances, number of available instances of each type. So it will be n times f, n times m matrix for the allocation. In that case, similar algorithm, work equals available. You start similarly, finish values are false. If allocation is zero, finish is false. If allocation exists, finish is true. So find a number such that both finish is zero, which is a new free process, and request that it makes is less than the available instances. If everybody is not getting anything, then go to 4. 4 means if everybody is false, or all of them is false, nobody is getting nothing, that means system is in deadlock state. Everybody is waiting, need is, where is it? Okay. Work is less than allocation, but cannot be given because finish is false. Then, if no one can be granted with the resources, that means it is false for all the processes, then system is in deadlock state. Furthermore, for the ones that are in that have false values, false flags, those are the elements of the cycle. Some of them may not be elements of the cycle. If there is a cycle in the process list, related finish flags will be false and they will be waiting for each other. This will require, this is actually undoable, the m times n square operations to detect whether the system is in deadlock state. And that is required to run frequently, which is very hard operation. But if you are sending a computer to Mars, for example, you need to check for deadlocks, even if it is costly, because there is no way to reboot it generally. There is no way to reboot it easily. For certain conditions, it may be required, but generally, it is not done. Instead, there is a heartbeat mechanism. Heartbeat mechanism is a hardware timer construct that periodically checks for certain operation in the operating system. If that is not updated for a certain amount of time, then the whole system is reset, assuming that there is a deadlock or waiting issue, waiting longer than the expected, waiting longer than the possible range, then the system can be reset. Or watchdog. What is the difference between heartbeat and the watchdog? They are similar things. In the watchdog, you need to reset. You need to reset a timer from your processes, shared variable. If you don't reset the timer, and if it overflows, overflow interrupt will cause a reset. Therefore, in order to prevent reset, your processes should frequently reset the timer, the common timer, so that common timer is a hungry dog to be fed, so that if you feed the dog, it stays calm. In the heartbeat, operating system provides signal. The process sends signal to some certain monitor application. That monitor application, if the monitor application doesn't get any signal variable from the process, then operating system thinks that that process is not working anymore. So it is locked. You need to restart it. So heartbeat is more operating system level, whereas watchdog or distributed system level. Watchdog is more like on chip level and embedded level. So again, similarly, allocation request available algorithm. You check the state. If the state does not allow further progress, for example, this, there is no deadlock here. If there is false, then there will be a deadlock, because in that case, you cannot move forward. Up to this point, no deadlock, but another instance is required, type C, P2. There is no available resources, so when you request that, and allocation is 303, so it is holding certain resources, then there is deadlock. And this scenario, P1, P2, P3, and P4, except P0, because it's not requesting anything, is creating deadlock. These four processes create a significant deadlock here. System is in deadlock state. It is very similar to detecting unsafe state, because in the unsafe state, we use max as a measure. Here we use allocation request and available as a measure. Same idea. Do we use it? Do we use it? No. So in many cases it is disregarded, but as you are using semaphores and mutual exclusion issues, we are teaching this because you need to be aware of this fact, and it may happen. Therefore, writing your code in order to prevent deadlocks is the main issue. So writing safe code, not declaring too many variables to use, and closing the resources, freeing the resources as soon as you finish it, finish using, is very important in writing the applications. Also, if detection algorithm is invoked arbitrarily from time to time, there may be many cycles in the resource graph, so we would not be able to tell which of the many deadlock process caused deadlock. That means we will be killing a lot of processes, a lot of victim processes who may be innocent. So innocent processes will be rolled back if the algorithm is run not frequently. Once you detect it, you abort all the processes, or abort one process at a time and detect, run the detection algorithm at each time. If the deadlock is eliminated, at some point detection algorithm will be free. You'll find a free path, then you should move forward. In which order we should abort the processes? One is the priority of the process. High priorities have less likely to be aborted. If it is a long process, you may think that it is a big process to kill. So I should kill it, or I should not kill it. It's a decision. How many resources processes use? If the process is using too many resources, maybe it's good to kill that. Some processes need to complete soon that may stay, others may be killed. How many processes will need to be terminated is an issue. Depends on the size of the deadlock. And it depends also if the process is not interactive, it may be interrupted, it may be terminated and restarted because nothing is going to happen to user. So these are decisions. These are decisions based on what you are doing with the operating system. But generally, banker's algorithm kind of based on declaration, use, and need is executed all the time. So if a new need is going to be fulfilled, you determine the condition of the next state. If the next state is unsafe, you don't give it. Or you run the detection algorithm. You try to check whether the need cannot be fulfilled. And you say, need cannot be fulfilled. Then I am in a deadlock. So that's one strategy, saying that I am in a deadlock, or I will be in a deadlock, or I may be in a deadlock because max is declared value. Then avoid giving it. Two strategies. When you are recovering from deadlock, you select the victim, you roll back the victim. And if the victim is a bad guy, using a lot of resources and not high priority, etc., so it may starve. Therefore, each time you roll back a victim, you should increase its priority. You should increase its priority so that it will not be rolled back next time if there is a deadlock, or the third time if there is a deadlock. Otherwise, it cannot finish its tasks. I think we are done with chapter 8. I am not going to continue with the chapter 9 today. If you have any question, let me know. And also, we should discuss about exam date. How is this date for exam? Okay, our exam will be on 17th of November. Okay, in class. At 14 o'clock. Okay.